real world dynamic range has a mess. You know, from the darkest thing going into a dark closet to going outside and looking at it up at the sun, a ton of dynamic range. Cameras, image capture devices can only capture a certain amount of that. DPs, their job is to decide what part of the real world's dynamic range their limited capture device is going to capture. And then down here, we have the display device. The display device is going to be film projected in a theater or something that you're looking at on your TV at home or streaming to your watch or whatever it is you damn kids do today. So, and that only, that shows less dynamic range, traditionally. You know, we're going to talk of, you know, we're going to sort of leave the whole question of HDR, you know, aside for this presentation. So the question comes up, how do we take what we've captured and map it onto what we're going to display? And the first thing we could do is this. Well, let's take everything we captured and put it on the display. And then we get a picture like this. Hopefully my internet is keeping up, so the slides are shifting at the right point. Notice there's a picture. Her name is Marcy. She looks very, very flat, dull, low contrast. And this makes sense. We took a lot of dynamic range and we're compressing it, showing it on a lower dynamic range device. So what can we do? Well, maybe, you know, and I'm going to plow through this a little quickly. Instead of taking everything we shot, why don't we match them? Why don't we take what we shot, the portion of what we shot that matches the dynamic range of the display and do that? Which is increasing contrast. That's where we were. Now we're going to increase the contrast. And she looks a little better. You know, she still looks, you know, and that's where we were. That's, you know, useless. That's like, you know, just a long image. And now this is where we are. It's okay. And your display devices are contrasty that you're looking at. So she might even look fine. But, you know, most colorists or creatives would say that it still looks low contrast. Why? Color science. If you show something at a lower luminance, the human perception, you know, our visual system will perceive it as lower contrast, and same with colorfulness. Here's an example. All four of these pictures have the same dynamic range. I am merely showing them to you at lower luminances. And as you can see, the lower the luminance, the lower the contrast as we perceive it. A few other things, display flare. Always reduces contrast. This is especially important in things like movie theaters, but even on displays. You have something bright, it's going to flare out and sort of fog the rest of it. And then surround conditions are also important. Dark theater surround versus if you're looking at something on a TV with the lights on in your living room, all of these are important. But so the stuff, it still looks dull. What do? You guessed it. We're going to increase the contrast once more. So this is where we were, sort of matching the dynamic range, and now we're going to increase the contrast, but she looks much better, right? I mean, she looks more like the type of image we would see. Now, there are some issues. As you can see, we have some shadow detail here. We have some highlight. You know, it's not a lot, a little bit of highlight detail there. But when we increase that contrast, we lose all the shadow detail in the background, and the highlights get a little clippy. I mean, it makes sense. We just sort of increased the contrast and clipped it. So there's this thing we all know and love. We're going to add a toe and a shoulder. It's going to bring back some of the highlight shadow detail. Here's a look of it. It's the blue curve here. It's an S curve, an S-shaped curve. And the thing about it is, you know, let's just show it. This is where we were. Notice we clipped all the shadow detail there. Here's the S curve. We bring a little of it back. You probably can't see it that well, I'm sorry to say. But maybe you can. And the highlight detail in the hair is, you know, not clips that much. But, you know, so the main point here is this S-curve tone mapping is your friend. And the thing is, a lot of people think that this S-curve was developed for film. They think that S-curve is a limitation of the photochemical process. There's something about it. In fact, when digital cameras first came out, there were some people who said, I don't want that. I don't want that S-curve. I want this to look real. I don't want that film artifact. And so they started shooting stuff, and it looked like badly shot video because it had clipped highlights and clipped shadows and looked horrible. I mean, sorry, value judgment, you know. And, you know, it took a while to realize. And my point for talking about this stuff like, what does this have to do with film? Or is, I want to say, this S curve is not a limitation of film. It's not a byproduct of film. It was designed into film. Eastman Kodak, for a period of time, had more psychologists on staff than color scientists and chemical engineers. What was important to them is that things feel right, that things look right, that someone snaps a photo, they pick up their photo from 1 hour, you know, and it goes, yeah, that looks really good. That's what, how I remember it looking. And the problem is we're capturing things in the real world high dynamic range. We have to display them on lower dynamic range display devices. And this S-curve is a way of doing it.